Remain standing for our first hymn this morning on page 577, God of Grace and God of Glory. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. 1, 2, and 4, page 577. Call to worship this morning is a responsive reading found in your bulletin. King of all the earth, creator of the universe, from everlasting to everlasting, you are Lord. You bring life, O Lord, and we meditate on you day and night.
Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
You are a rich stream of living waters, and we would immerse ourselves in you. You bring forth fruit in due season and establish the work of our hands.
Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
Who is like our God, the one whose ways are full of life?
Happy are we when we walk in your ways, O Lord.
This is our God, the Holy One. Come before him with thanksgiving and offer him the sacrifice of praise. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. Welcome to Mount Zion United Methodist Church. Do we have any first-time guests with us this morning? If so, please raise your hand. First-timers this morning. Let me direct your attention to the flowers. The flowers are to the glory of God and in honor of Carol Gibby's birthday, placed with love from her mother and dad. Thank you very much for the flowers, and happy birthday to Carol. Any announcements this morning? Matt?
Lifeline back to back, when they start to pray for these, care back to them, they're in the hospital.
Thanks, Matt. Please continue to bring in your supplies to help support those efforts. Jake?
Just a reminder, the gathering is next Sunday at 10 a.m. It's our contemporary worship service. A good friend of mine, Joseph Sojourner, is coming to speak. We've got a live worship band as well. So 10 a.m., everybody's invited. Thanks.
Next Sunday morning for the gathering at 10 a.m.? Not 9:48? Are we going with 10 a.m.? 12 extra minutes.
Sunday night, November the 28th, Men's Club sponsored. We couldn't figure out this morning what the Men's Club actually does, but we schedule it. So it's scheduled 6 o'clock on the 28th, covered dish, across the street, plus call for the Christmas program. So last year we had to do it virtual, and we had to catch it on TV, but now we're live again this Sunday the 28th, 6 o'clock, plus call. Break a covered dish with something in it, they tell me. So look forward to seeing it. And also, today, this is not affiliated with Mount Zion at all. It's not affiliated with Mount Zion, that's for sure. So there's a question and answer session for the presentation by a man from the Western Covenant Association. It's going to be down at Diamond Hulu at 3 o'clock down the Central Avenue. And I hope everybody will come ask some questions about kind of what's going on and what are some options going forward, what's the schedule, and things like that. Again, not affiliated with this church, not affiliated with the United Methodist Church, but Western Covenant Association, 3 o'clock, Donahue Lewis and Hayden.
3 o'clock this afternoon for a Q&A at Donahue Lewis, and November 28th at 6 p.m. for the Men's Club Christmas program. Any other announcements? About praises or prayer concerns? Wayne McCurdy.
Don Cobb and Barbara Prater.
Marcia. Yes, ma'am. Praise for that and continue to put you on the prayer list. Marcia Lamb.
And thank you for the food.
Yes, ma'am. Becky Simonton. Yes, ma'am.
My parents,
Robert and Lily Hicks.
Virginia Morgan.
The Wallace family. Graham.
Carl Hayes and family.
Nancy Lowndes.
Carol and Don Cobb.
Bill?
Mega Simpson.
Mega Simpson. Yes, sir.
Donna Hines and Rosa Lanham.
Steve? You have any Christmas lights that don't work? Steve would be glad to take them off your hands. Thank you. Rosa. Jose Andres Mendez.
And Rosa's traveling.
Traveling mercies for Rosa. Any others? If there are no more, we'll take these to the Lord in prayer.
O Lord God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, we acclaim you, we praise you, we exalt you, we bless your holy name. Lord, grant us eyes today to see the power of your word and your power in our own lives. We've made mistakes. There may well be times we remember walking in the way of the wicked and sitting at the table of the ungodly. Thank you, God, for your forgiveness. May your word be our delight and our satisfaction. May our lives bear the fruit that come from being planted in streams of your living water. Help us, O God, to always keep your power and your authority and your love and your majesty in our minds, and to never neglect the doing of your will. Help us to be obedient, God. God, thank you, God, most holy, for hearing our prayers. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and with the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. And thus we pray as Christ taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Right now, Drew and Nicole Pittman, parents, and Mary McCurdy, godmother, and any family and friends to come forward. Please bring your United Methodist hymnals, and we'll be turning to page 39. What is the name given to this child?
Palmer Elaine Pittman.
Palmer Elaine Pittman. We present Palmer Elaine Pittman for baptism. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you this, I ask her parents, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church that by your teaching and your example they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? And now I ask these questions of everyone, of the congregation, of all who are gathered here. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and in Christian faith and life, and include this beautiful child now before you in your care. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround this child with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. Let's join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and the New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Excuse me, Sophie. Let's pray. Eternal God, when nothing existed but chaos, when you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light, in the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. O Holy God, pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and this child who will receive it, to wash away her sin and clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that died and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, and your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. You all couldn't see it. She has just had the most beautiful smile at me. She knows what's going on, y'all. She is excited. She is excited. Step forward a little, just a little bit. She is excited at what is going on today. Palmer, I baptize you in the name of the Father. I know it's a little cool. And of the Son. Amen. We can place your hands on this child. May the Holy Spirit work within you, that you may be born of water and the Spirit as a true disciple of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It is our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. Palmer, look. Look, I know, your mother's right there. She's right there. You are a beautiful child of God. Welcome to this congregation. Welcome to God's holy church. Welcome. Hey, You want to go back to mommy? You feel very welcome with mommy, don't you? It's okay. It's okay. Look at your church. Look at your people. These are people who love you. These are people who will pray for you. Why am I not handing you back to mommy? You're asking. These are people who will nurture you. These are people who will teach you. This is your family, Palmer. This is your family. Welcome. Welcome to God's household. Welcome. We love you, Palmer. Members of the household of God, I commend Palmer to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, to confirm her hope, and to perfect her in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. May the God of all grace, who has called you, may He confirm you and establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Amen. Welcome, Palmer. Welcome.
At this time, we'll continue our singing on page 611, Child of Blessing, Child of Promise. Page 611, please stand.
To come forward. Y'all just saw a big reason we give this morning. When we baptize an infant, we give so we can bring these children up in the faith. There's just a beautiful reason, beautiful, beautiful reason this morning. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for all your many good gifts. You are the giver of every good gift, God, most especially your Son, Jesus Christ, who has given himself to us. God, may we give with a spirit of joy, with a spirit of generosity, with a spirit of trust in knowing that you are our God who provides for everything. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is Psalm chapter 1 on page 489 in the Old Testament of your pew Bible. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. At this time, we'd like for the children to come down for the children's message.
Good morning. I got a big crowd this morning. I'm so glad to see y'all. So we're going to play a little game. When you see these, what do you see? They're leaves and sticks. And what else about them? Are they brown? That's because they dead. There ain't no life left in those. I mean, they gone. They have seen better days. Okay. Now, when you see this, what do you see? It's a plant. It is, and it's green. It's not dead. Believe it or not, Miss Ann, miracle of all miracles, has kept this alive for a year. A whole year. If y'all knew how black this thumb was when it comes to plants, y'all would understand. But you see how he's all green? And look, he's got some new leaves right there that are red. Y'all see those? So during the summer, he had these little blooms on him that would come out. And they were like little sticks. It was really neat. But see, he's in the wintertime, but he's still green. So he stays green all year, as long as you water him. I mean, we had a couple of bad days there because that leaf's got a hole in it. But, I mean, we're coming back. I mean, we're making a comeback. So, like that, you want to be green. Like, you don't want it, like, this is lifeless, right? Well, that has life in it. And that's what we want to be like, right? So in order for us to have life in us, we have to do certain things. So like with this plant, you have to water it. You have to give it plant food. You have to change out its dirt. I mean, you just got to make sure he's going to survive. Or he's going to end up looking like these dead leaves, which we don't want. So like that, we have to do things. So we have to pray. We have to come to church. We have to read our Bibles. So we'll be full of life. Right? Okay. All right. So we're going to pray, and then I will give you guys your candy. Okay? Dear Lord, thank you for this day and for all that you've given us. And Lord, thank you so much for letting us all be able to come here today and worship you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Ann. At this time, we ask you to stand up, greet your neighbor, tell him God loves you.
rivers and trees, rivers and trees. That's how Scripture begins, and that's the way the Bible ends too. When in the book of Genesis is described the earth that God created, Genesis contains the descriptions of rivers that flow to the Garden of Eden. And then, of course, there are trees in the Garden of Eden. There are so many trees of which the people that God created can eat. And then, of course, there's the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which gets Adam and Eve into trouble. And the tree of life is planted there too. And then, you know the story, because the humans give in to that temptation to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they're banished from the garden. The rivers and the trees are still there. The garden is still there, but the humans are banished. They're just not allowed. And then at the end of your Bible, once you get up to Revelation, once humanity has been redeemed, and there's a new heaven and a new earth, we find John's vision there, the vision of John of Patmos. He writes, "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. On either side of the river is the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, producing its fruit each month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations." So there's rivers and trees at the very beginning, and then rivers and trees at the end. And here in the middle as well, here in our first psalm, rivers and trees. The righteous are like trees planted by streams of water. It's kind of where we find ourselves too. We're kind of somewhere between the middle and the end, whenever that is. We last week we celebrated All Saints Day. We celebrated and rejoiced that the saints had gone on to be with God in the kingdom, that they were part of that they were by those rivers of flowing water. And then today we rejoiced at Palmer's baptism, that she too had that water, that she too was part of that grace, that flowing water, that living water. We pray that's where Palmer, of course, is firmly planted, right there by that flowing river. That she is like a tree planted by streams of water. We start out teaching children right from wrong, and then we hope that as we teach them right from wrong, we hope that from all that comes faith. And that's really a desire, I think, that we all share. I think we can all share that desire, that we be one of those happy ones, that we be one of those blessed ones who will delight in God like a tree planted by the water. Plant me by the river, Lord. It's a prayer I think we've all shared in some form or fashion. Plant me by the river, Lord. I want to be like the righteous. I want to stand. I want to stand. I don't want to be like the chaff that the wind blows away. I don't want to be just dust in the wind. I don't want to be vapor floating into nothingness. I want my life to matter. I want my life to matter. I want it to come to something, right? I think we can all share that. You want your life to matter. Of course you do. I want my life to matter. That's a big reason why I preach, because I want you to know that your life matters. That's why I do what I do, because I want you to know that your life does matter. I mean, it becomes sometimes we feel like though it's always about that dash, like we just dash around. We dash around, we hurry and scurry, and do this and do that. We gotta run and do this and fix this. Oh, this is out of whack, and we get imbalanced and have to go and pay attention to this over there, and we're just running hither and to and fro, just dashing around, just this mad dash everywhere. Do this and do that. Oh, I'm running late. I got to make sure I eat enough. Got to make sure I stay hydrated and all that. Say hello to this person. Say goodbye to this person. Run around some more. And then before you know it, it's over. And that life is just this mad dash. There are a bunch of, if you go out into the cemetery, there are a bunch of dashes. Right? All of those graves have two numbers on them. And in between those numbers is a dash. The year they born, the year they died, and a dash right there in the middle. Just a little dash. And that dash, it represents all the time we have. Just that little dash. What are you going to do with your dash? I want my dash to matter. And our psalm today, the first of the psalms, the introduction to the whole book of Psalms, lays it out pretty simply. We have two choices. There's a fork in the path, right? There's the way of the righteous or the way of the wicked. And again, as it says, the way of the righteous is faithful and joyful and fruitful. The righteous are like trees planted by streams of water. The wicked are not so. They're dry. They're like dust. They're like chaff. Plant me by the river, Lord. Plant me by the river. And that's real, right? I mean, the psalm talks about the wicked. I mean, this thing about these two paths, right? That's real. The wicked, unfortunately, are real. There are wicked people in this world. You know what I mean by that is there are folks whom we see and we shake our heads and say, how could anyone act like that? How could anyone do that? What's the matter with them? On all sorts of levels. There's like the genocidal dictator level, and then there's like just the everyday kind of more mundane wickedness that we see every day. People taking advantage of each other. People being dishonest. Greed and adultery and just apathy where people stop caring. I mean, wickedness is all around. And there are folks, there are people sometimes who will look at wickedness and tragedy. They'll look at things like in the news of people being trampled to death at a concert or children getting kidnapped or just, you know, people calling each other names on social media and people look at that and say, like, well, there's a reason for everything. It's all part of God's plan. And now at its best, comments like that mean nothing. And they shed no light on anything. They really don't mean much. They don't illuminate anything. They don't bring a new understanding to anything. And at their worst, comments like that make God sound pretty wicked himself. And that's not God's nature. You know, as we read in the baptismal vow this morning, there are spiritual forces of wickedness. There are evil powers in this world that we renounce. We say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce that. They are not of God. They are of the enemy. Evil is real. And the thing about it is, I can't give you a great answer as to why it exists. I can't give you a great answer of why. I can't say exactly, you know, why it's there. I can't say why bad things happen. I can say what I know is it's not of God. And that ultimately God does reign. I can tell you that too. Evil will not have the final word. Love will have the final word. That Christ has triumphed over the powers of evil. And Christ will reign. Christ does reign all throughout eternity. Now I know that. That I do know. But in the meantime, during our dash, we wonder why those bad things happen. Why is there wickedness? Why is there evil? We can't help it. When I was preaching at New Liberty United Methodist, there's a woman there who had a grown son, and she just loved him. That's what mothers do. They love their children. And he was somewhere, I think he was in his late 40s or in his 50s, somewhere, I guess. And he was addicted to drugs. He just couldn't shake it. He was addicted, right? And she'd come to me. She'd come to me and she would be weeping for her son. And I'd sit with her in the sanctuary and we would pray, Lord, how we prayed for him. And one night we allowed him to park his car outside at the church one night. And he spent the night out there in the parking lot so I could go out there and speak with him in the morning. She thought, well, maybe if Josh goes out there and speaks to him, maybe he can, I don't know, talk some sense to him or somehow. And I talked to him, and his body was all bent out of shape from whatever he'd been smoking and from sleeping in his truck and everything. And he wouldn't admit to me. He wouldn't admit to doing anything wrong. But his eyes were calling for help. You could see it in his eyes. And he prayed with me. And I don't know what's up with him today. Honestly, I don't know. His mother prayed and prayed and prayed that somehow someone might be able to make a difference that no one else had made. I mean, I've talked to his mother since then. She says he's doing all right, but you hear a crack in her voice. There was so much hurt. There was so much alienation that she had from her son. There was so much disappointment. There was so much of like where she was blaming herself and she really shouldn't have been blaming herself and all this guilt that she had that she really shouldn't have had. It was just a misplaced guilt. And she would just pray that all would not be lost for her boy. And in those prayers really was the same question the prophet Jeremiah asked. Why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why do the faithless live at ease? Because somehow that wickedness had touched her son. Don't let evil have its way, Lord. Don't let wickedness consume my son, she would pray. Life, you know, life can be such a struggle. She loved him so, she labored so. Plant us by the river, Lord. Plant him by the river. And there are a lot of us who've prayed these same prayers. Why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why, God? Why? Our best intentions sometimes. You know, our most honest prayers, like we work so hard. And our best intentions and our very best efforts, that they get real, our heartfelt efforts sometimes bring about so little fruit sometimes. You feel like you might as well not have done anything. Why did I even try? Why did I work so hard? It looks like it didn't matter. I want to be planted by the river, Lord. Why does it seem dry as the dust? And that was exactly what a lot of people felt who Jesus preached to. You know, at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, It was just a celebration, right? There was water into wine at the wedding. There was bread and fish for thousands and thousands of people. And people had sacrificed so much to follow Jesus. But to what end? He started making strange comments about his death. And the doors of the synagogue were closed to him. And the religious leaders, these influential people that people looked up to, that they were like his bitterest, his worst enemies. You know, people had come to see miracles, and yet what were they getting? And as it says in the Gospel of John, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. And of course, finally, at the end, it was just him. It was just Jesus up there, lonely on the cross. One of his closest disciples, Peter, had denied he ever even knew him. On the cross, the curtain of the temple torn in two as Jesus prayed, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And now what Jesus is doing there when he prays that, that's a quotation of Psalm 31, where verse 5 there says, "Into your hands I commit my spirit. You have redeemed, O Lord. You have redeemed my life, O faithful God." Dietrich Bonhoeffer is not the only person who's called the Psalms the prayer book of the Bible. That's what the Psalms are. This is our prayer book. These are prayers that God gives us to pray. Bonhoeffer says we can learn true prayer only from Jesus Christ, from the Word of the Son of God who lives with us human beings, to God the Father who lives in eternity. Jesus Christ has brought every need, every joy, every gratitude, every hope of humanity before God. And so Psalm 1 today, this first psalm, is just the introduction to this book of prayers we have, where every fear and every doubt and every worry and every wonder of like, God, where are you? Every word of anger, even. There's anger in some of the Psalms at a God, sometimes where people are asking, God, don't you even care? And also every joy and every gratitude and every vow of faith is there in this prayer book, is there in the Psalms. It's all here. It's all here. And so we bring our whole selves to God. We bring every single bit of ourselves to God. That's what we're called to do. And God does the planting. Plant me by the river, Lord. Plant me by the river. The way of the righteous that the psalm talks about. The way of the righteous, it's not so much about like what we're supposed to do, but it's more of how we are supposed to be. It's not a what so much as a how. It's being completely honest. It's being completely open. It's being completely broken. It's saying, God, I'm nothing without you. God, I need you. I need you, God. Completely in need of the one who loved you first. More than anything you can do, it's a state of being. That state of being called trust. That state of a deep, abiding, accepting faith. Trusting in God like you trust in the air you breathe. And that's how God's going to plant you by the river. There's this album me and my family listen to when we sometimes... We listen to it a lot at night when sometimes we'll go to my parents' house for dinner at night, and And then it starts to get late. And so what we do is we'll give our daughter her bath over at their house and get her ready, put on her pajamas and get everybody there in the car. We get William, we get Marissa in there and get them both. And then we put on an album. And we've got this album that we've been listening to. I think we were listening to it like the week we got Marissa home from the hospital. The album is called Be Held, and it's by a woman named Christy Knuckles. I don't know if you've ever heard Christy Knuckles. It's a beautiful, beautiful album. It's called Be Held, Lullabies for the Beloved. It's an album of lullabies. And there is a song on there called River of Grace. And it says, "Won't you go there with me down to the riverside where the water runs free? And you can let your heart swing open wide. Oh, won't you let it swing open wide? Because all it takes is a little bit of faith. And Jesus comes and carries it away down the river of grace. Oh, the river of grace. Plant me by the river, Lord." God does not neglect His children. Y'all, God does not neglect His children. Jesus says, "As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. Plant me by the river, Lord. Lord, plant me by that river of grace. That's what I want my dash to look like. I want my dash to look like that river of grace. Just that whole way. That whole way through it. Just that river of grace." And that's what it does look like. That's what it does look like for every single one of us if we open our eyes. If we bring our whole self. If we're completely open, completely honest. If we bring every minute, every single bit of ourselves, if we're open to it, that river of grace. Oh, plant me by the river, Lord. Plant me by the river. Amen.
Our closing hymn is on page 445, Happy the Home When God Is There. We'll sing the first and last, page 445. Please stand.
Family of God, may our good Lord Jesus Christ plant you firmly by that river. May you always bear good fruit and always know whose you are and where you can always abide.